各位同事早晨。
Morning. The Welfare Service Panel April meeting will convene now. The first item that I need to deal with is Mrs. Regina Ip has requested to join. Do we have any objection? Mrs. Regina Ip told me that she couldn't attend this morning's meeting because she just got off a flight, but she does want to join our work. Do we have any objections? This is the CE election candidate, and she learned a lot about welfare during the period, and she would like to contribute her experience. Any objections? If not, so we accept Mrs. Regina Yip's application. And since our previous meeting, we haven't received any further information. The next item for discussion at the next meeting, the government has wanted to talk about the children's child care and I also want to follow up on Singleton's issues. Do you agree or object to these items? Fernando Cheung has two suggestions regarding the next meeting. Fernando Cheung would like to host two deputations. So, Mr. Fernando Cheung, could you elaborate regarding social welfare in public rental housing? We do need to hear from deputations. We have a lot of new PRH that are almost completed or about to be completed. And between 2015-16 and 2019-20, we have 75,000 PRH units. So we need to provide relevant services, otherwise we'll see some family tragedies. We also have non-profit organizations. Previously in the block allocation, there were a lot of equal work but unequal pay problems, and there was also criticisms against management, and recently we had concerns about remuneration transparency, and we received a lot of views from deputations, and we'd like a discussion and have it discussed in open deputation meeting. Mr. Fernando Cheung, do you have any timetable? I'd like to remind you, we have a deputation in early May regarding handicap welfare payment, and we also have a regular meeting in May regarding child rearing rights and visitation rights. So when would you like to hold these deputations? Well, after these two meetings end. It's also hard work if we attend too many meetings. Okay, let's queue them up and see which can be arranged first. Any objections to these two deputations? So we'll endorse that and we'll host two deputations. One about provision of social welfare services in PRH and transparency in remuneration. Agenda item number 4. Estate-based social welfare services planning. Let's invite the relevant officials. First of all, let's welcome the government officials. We have the Assistant Director from SWD. We also have the Administrative Officer as well. Okay, the first topic, provision of social welfare facilities in PRH. So could you take us through the document? The paper that we're providing, estate-based social welfare services planning, this involves two areas. The first, social welfare facilities planning, and the other is in new PRH social welfare services planning. So if you talk about planning of social facilities, the social welfare department has always taken a multi-pronged approach to increase the provision of social welfare facilities. The SWD will work with the relevant government departments and we will work with the housing authority in provision of PRH. We will set up welfare facilities. Now, regarding PRH, according to our existing mechanism, the planning department or housing department will consult with SWD and other government departments. They will consult the relevant district council, and in the PRH project, they will plan for our community facilities. In the process, the SWD will look at the overall demand and feasibility and will also respond to the social welfare demand and cater to society's needs. In our paper, we have detailed some of our considerations, including the district needs, the need for social welfare facilities, the gross floor area requirements, the location requirements, and transport accessibility, and also the relevant government departments' limitations on land use. So all these will be taken into consideration. In new PRH, we want to assist residents because they're residing in a new PRH in a new environment. The SWD regional offices, whenever there is a large PRH project, we will coordinate the relevant government departments. We will work with the NGOs and stakeholders. So whether it's through pamphlets, posters, communications, outreach workers, we will promote our services. And when people move into PRH, when they collect their keys or when they pay their deposit, we will arrange for introduction sessions. We'll introduce them to our facilities and services, and if they need to have needs, we can intervene at the appropriate time. The existing PRH, they also receive funding or through the Jockey Club Charitable Trust. They receive funds to develop community networks, and we help the residents through these projects. Thank you, Chairman. Okay. We'd like the government to understand that at 10 o'clock this morning, there was a IFSC concern group. There were four groups outside petitioning about residents moving in first and then only making plannings. So we now have legislators with questions. The speaking order is as follows: Wan Siu Kin, Lao Siu Lai, Kok Ka Ke, and Fernando Zheng, Neng Yu Zhong. So Wan Siu Kin, and 4 minutes. Well, we heard the official presentation, and that's in stark contrast to the public's perception. But we feel that over the last few decades, the government planning, they The PRH residents are pioneers in new development areas, and do we see, and even private building residents also feel the same. Why are the PRH in private surrounding private residences? So over the last few decades, we see history repeat itself. In Sati and Junmun, they have encountered the same development mode. And Dongchong, Jiangguan, as well, and then whether it's Suiqun or Hongfeng or Wangzhou, it will be the same, and Daibo as well. So, aside from social welfare, we're also concerned about education, the wet market. So we see that PRH residents move in and they create a demand. They will set aside some bus routes, and then. But the services are always playing a catch-up game. So there's no planning. In fact, it's just moving backwards. Okay. We talked about having interim measures. It's very difficult. The housing department is very stubborn. So in the past, the situation only gets worse. In the past, there was flexibility. They could see that NGOs could fill in. But now, we have planning time lag. I quote the Hongfuk estate as an example. There's a population forecast that it would increase. But what about the people that moved in? So I mentioned the daily necessities, education, hospital care, wet markets, and all this are lagging behind. So the whole planning has failed. There's a time lag. So if we were to do better, and let's use traffic as an example, we need some transport routes. We need, let's say, 10 routes, and they should provide at least 3 routes. So why can't you use this common sense approach rather than, let's say, you just plan and in 3 years' time when the housing units are full, they will have the services ready? Well, any PRH new development, we won't have people move in and then plan. So any new PRH development, at the beginning, before it's built, we have to decide what facilities, what social services need to be provided. For example, the Anderson new PRH development, we already have the Ondachun, and we're now building Ontai Estate, and we have set aside in Ondat Estate, we have an elderly center. There will be an integrated youth center in Ontai Estate. We also have elderly home, handicapped facilities, services for the handicapped. So we're not shoving people into PRH and then make planning.
Because when we build a public housing estate, there need to be spaces provided for welfare facilities. Deputy Director, well, when you mention Ontai Estate, I get angry. I've been there, and there's been newspaper reports on it that the integrated youth centers you mentioned that's run by Christian Social Service from 2016 till now, it hasn't yet begun operation. Because the 8,000 square feet flat is still under renovation, is still at construction site. So if you have made planning for it, why is it that the area is still under construction now? Well, the integrated youth center, service center, I've been there myself. The planning for that was done beforehand. So there was plan for this youth center to be built. But when we got the occupation permit, we need to submit plans to the housing department for approval so the renovation can begin with the approval. this integrated center will be actually fully renovated within this year. But 2016 till end of 2027, that's too long, an empty period. Isn't that abnormal? Well, the day of the occupation permit was actually middle of 2016. So we need to draw a plan after getting the permit to have the retrofitting work and other renovation work done. So it really takes time for approval to be obtained. And we also need to get the housing department to approve the plan. But of course, in the approval period, we could have sped up our work. So you feel that things could have moved faster, right? You got the permission in 2016 and the place won't be ready for use till end of 2017. So you think the period could have been shortened, right? Yes, I think there's room for us to have acted more quickly. But another service facility, the service center for the elderly, will be ready for use by July this year. Okay. How about the housing department on this case? You know, the ONTEC Estate Integrated Youth Service Center, which was got the approval in 2016, and yet it won't be occupied until end of 2017. This sort of time frame could it have been shortened? Did the House Department take too long to give approval? What are the reasons for the long delay? Ms. Yang, could you answer? Thank you for your question. Let me explain to you the procedures required. Normally speaking, we've noticed that some welfare facilities and community facilities, the service providers concerned, that is the NGOs who are running those facilities, they do need to carry out retrofitting or renovation work or even refurbishment work at the site concerned, so as to meet the types of operations or to match the operations that they're going to provide. And all those renovation works require government department's approval, and they need to be done in compliance with legal requirements. In this case, the time needed, well, it all depends on the nature of the works concerned and the scope of the works. So we can't really generalize here. But if you look at some other cases, whether the workflow for approval could have been shortened, I think for housing department would indeed try our best to help the NGOs concerned. In the past, we have taken the initiative to contact the NGOs to find out, you know, whether they need any assistance from us during the approval process. And we would streamline the procedures instead of just follow the steps strictly. In some cases, we did contact the organizations concerned. Yeah, my question was, Ms. Yang, on the case in ONTEC Estate, the Youth Service Center, had you streamlined the entire process? As you said, do you think that you could have skipped some steps to speed up the process? Do you know that for the social workers and, you know, to be offering counseling and tutorial lessons on the street, it's really ridiculous. But that's what's happening now. I don't have any information on the ONTEC Estate case, so I don't know how come it took so long and what was happening to the workflow. I don't have the information with me right now, but I'm happy to, after the meeting, and look up information about the ONTEC Estate case. Yes, because we have seen, you know, service providers offering tutorial classes, aftercare support, after school support, and also counseling, you know, on the street, setting up stores there. So we're not in the 1970s now. So please provide us with supplementary information. Next one, Lao Siu Lai. Thank you, members. I think we share the same view. We know that things should be done step by step. But the question is, why can't you compress the whole process? Just then, the official's response made me even angrier. You had planning, and yet you carry out with the procedure so slowly. You had planning, but you failed to provide services in a speedy manner, even though you knew that there is the need. There are elderly people, grassroots families who are in much need of support, and yet you're not acting fast enough. So in the years when people are waiting for the services, people in the grassroots and elderly people, you know, all these families, how can they cope? I'm particularly concerned with the issues of the elderly people. Among the vulnerable, elderly people are the most vulnerable. They cannot walk easily. Sometimes they cannot take good care of themselves. So when they're waiting in the two, three years period, who will look after them? So I'd like to ask the government, can we actually provide the home care services for the elderly earlier? Our service teams right now are in such a shortage in old districts like Kun Tong, Wong Tai Sin. There are some service teams which need to handle 7-8 cases at the same time. So if you are providing services so late, then elderly people who've moved into new estates will have to wait for 2-3 years before being helped. So who can take care of them when they're just staying there alone in their homes? How can elderly people help themselves? So I'd just like to ask the official, can you speed up and compress your procedures so that you can provide, let the service be provided when the estate is ready for occupation? Okay, you said that on the estate there will be an NEC, but what's the latest now, Mr. Lam? In Onta Estate, the elderly neighborhood elderly centers by March 30th has been opened. Even though the premises would not have the renovation done till early July, but because the organization running it has a NEC nearby area, so it's using mobile vehicles and so forth to provide services for the elderly in the area. And also, as mentioned by the member, the integrated family care service for elderly people, the team in Shomoping indeed has expanded the services to the areas in Kun Tong, and there are 7 daycare centers for the elderly in the area, and the service teams are actually providing services to people living in Onta Estate, and also the Onta Estate to be built. And for the Anderson Road development, there are 5 organizations that have been recommended by the SWD to get support from CIF and the Jockey Club to provide the services, and each of the service projects will last for 3 years to help the future residents integrate into the new living environment. Okay, despite what you said, doesn't mean that elderly people will get all the services they need. Can you review the services, and also whether you think the planning figures are reasonable? You always said that you have done your work, but indeed what happened is that what you've done turned out to be inadequate and people are not getting the support they need. Would you review the situation? Well, definitely we're not really doing things in a slow pace. We do hope that through the establishment of PRH estates, more services can be provided, but we would try to compress the process and get services ready ASAP. Okay, small question here. Just then you said that you're going to get CIF and the Hong Kong Jockey Club funding support to finance 3-year projects. Do you think that 3 years can help two people in two large estates? One Onta Estate has 23,000 residents alone to help them adapt to the new environment. Do you think 3 years will be enough? Why can't you provide regular services instead? All the new services are provided through the Jockey Club and the CIF. So what's the role of the SWD? Do you think 3 years is enough? The 3-year projects are intended to help new residents in the public housing estates to adapt and also know about the services available in their neighborhood. So in terms of adaptation period, we think that 3 years is enough. But of course, within the 3 years, if their residents were found to be in need of long-term service, we do have regular services available in the district. And so the projects I mentioned are intended to help connect the residents to regular services in the area. Next one, Kwakaki. Chairman, as I was listening, I thought that the two departments are coming from two planets. The housing department and the SWT didn't know about each other's existence. Okay, I trust you when you say that there's a service center which will be running, but then it will take 1.5 years for it to be renovated. But is it because of some obstacles posed by the housing department? Or is it because you know that there will be elder centers and youth centers to be opening? Why can't they let the centers be ready when the estate is completed instead of having the centers submit their plans and get approval after the estate has been completed? Deputy Director, I haven't seen such kind of development approach. As housing department, would that be, you know, what's happening to your own office? Like in what happened to Ontech Estate, would you let the same thing happen to housing department, that is, you have the building completed and then you ask for permission and plan for your own office? You are asking Deputy Director of the housing department, right, Ms. Yeo? Did the housing department pose obstacles to the SWT, Ms. Yeo? Okay. Let me explain to you the procedures involved. Social welfare facilities, on the whole, they do need to meet legal requirements in terms of the uses, because some organizations may... Well, when did you know that whether it's for youth or elder people, when did you know the centers will be built? They had planned ahead, right, for them? Yes. The planning for the purposes were known to us. Say we knew that it would be a youth center. We knew about the use proposed. But as I just said, some organizations, because they need to carry out renovation or retrofitting at the premises to suit their operations, like for the design of toilets, so they need to have the toilets designed in accordance with Hong Kong's legal requirements. So they will be required to provide proposals to relevant government departments for approval. Sorry, Chairman, let's stop here first. When did you receive the information that they needed retrofitting at the premises? Why is it that elderly centers and youth centers would be something like that? You had no idea what they will be used for? This is not something new. It won't be the first time you heard about a youth center at a public housing estate. It's not that we didn't know about the plan for housing, how youth center.
As I said just now, the washroom might need to be reprovisioned. The question I asked, was it the SWD or the HD that held this issue up? Chairman, I haven't finished my answer. The question was, HD, when do we receive the application? The application, the SWD, in this case, they will nominate an NGO. The NGO, they need to make an application with the HD. So when are we aware? So when the NGO, when they submit some applications, then we will start the vetting process. And as I said just now, they need to comply with the relevant regulations. So from the HD, they are responsible for vetting, and we have an independent vetting committee to handle applications. This independent vetting committee, it comes under Transport Housing Bureau so they are also independent to HD other departments. this independent vetting committee needs to be authorized by the housing department, the housing authority, and so it involves many different departments. There's a lot of bureaucracy. So I have a question. So on that estate, the social welfare team, they have a temporary office and it has to be resumed. It only has 100-odd square feet and 6 people working there. And now HD wants to resume that office because they're not entitled to use it. Thank you, Chairman, for the question. I'd like to explain. Mr. Kokake asked about a recurrent facility. The chairman, you talk about a support team. It is roughly a 3-year service. So there is, it's different. For the latter, the support service, HD is willing to help, is willing to assist this support service. We can comply. We can provide a venue for the relevant team to provide the services. So, Mr. Young, are you pledging that you will find a venue for this estate support team? They're using a temporary space. Are you saying that you will provide them with a venue? Well, each estate is different. I'm talking about on that estate. According to my understanding, I don't have information regarding on that estate, but in general, the housing department is willing to coordinate. The SWD will assign some volunteer services. They have already been appointed. So as SWD assistant director said, the HD has provided a meeting room for the support service team. Well, I've never seen the service team and whatever service they have been aware of it a long time ago. They have waited a year and a half and they so later on I would like to put forth some motions that in all HD, SWD projects they need to give a service pledge, whether it's 3 months or 4 months. So these service centers have to be ready, otherwise it's hard to be accountable to the public, and they have to wait, they have to draw it out for more than a year. Fernando Joe, we're talking about PRH, serving the grassroots. We're not talking about private residents, luxury residences. We're worried about the clubhouse, whether it's ready or not, whether the swimming pool water temperature is appropriate. We're talking about basic services. When they move in to these new PRH, a lot of times it's still a construction site. They lack a lot of facilities. They're isolated, for example, on that, so you know, Tin Sui Wai. And for older estates, Chun Moon, they are like pioneers. Do we have any policy that before these residents move in, our social welfare facilities should be ready and open? And I'm saying before the residents move in, not after they move in. So over the years, we have been repeating ourselves. There's a NEC, there's a SYC, we have a IFSC. Everything has been planned. It will move in phases. So when they move in, this is not appropriate, that is not appropriate. They have an occupation permit, and then they find out this is wrong, that is not to their liking. And the NGO has proposals, they have to change, it has to be approved. So the residents will have already moved in a year or two, and the service is falling short. The funds have been granted, they don't have activities center, they don't have an office. And this has been, we have been repeating this over and over. So I don't care about your independent, dependent ICU. It takes more than 2 years for approval. So I don't matter what, you should have your social welfare facilities first and then issue occupation permits. Can you have that as a policy? Well, when occupation permits have been issued, there is always a correction process. I know there are a lot of corrections, so regardless of your corrections, so it should be all done before residents move in. You've already planned for the units. You can start the tender earlier. You can push everything forward earlier. Why do you have to wait till residents move in? And there are no services when residents move in. And we see family tragedies. We see this repeated over and over again in the tender process. We have made improvements. When the building is almost completed, the majority of our social services are on the ground floor or lower floors. We will ask the HD for building plans, because with the building plans, we can estimate how much money will be needed for renovation. But that should be available 2 years ago. You don't need to wait till the we're talking about the completion plans. So, well, of course there are building plans, but when you've completed, you have to check that they match. So we have compressed the timeline. So when service providers bid for the services, we already compressed the time. We've got the plans, and we've invited service providers. So when the occupation permits are ready, so let's talk about Ontai Estate. It's already built. What's the progress? What the completed building plans do you have? Or do we have to wait for Ontai to be occupied for a year? So let's talk about the future. Ontai is a good example. Near Ontai, we have a social welfare building for the disabled. We have invited NGOs to bid for these services, and these services will roll out in 2018. So you're preparing a tender now. We're preparing a tender now. But Ontai is already built. When will the occupation permits be issued? Ontai is still under construction. They haven't removed scaffolding. Langyuzhong, I'd like to clarify. Let's say we're talking about Daibo. It's being planned. So can you, let's say, if you have an integrated family service center or youth centers, it's already planned. So can you invite volunteer organizations now? So after they have been shortlisted, and ask institution ABC, how many square feet will they be given? Once they're given this information, the NGO can start planning what facilities, how many washrooms they need, and then they can submit it to the building department, and they can build it in one go. They can save construction costs and time. We don't create construction waste. So why do you have to wait till the occupation permit has been issued, and then you have to demolish and reinstall washrooms and so on? So it's it should be like the building department. They can plan in advance how many facilities they want. Why can't you do it that way? This is a very simple arrangement. I'm saying when you plan for the building, you can plan the units, you can install the facilities. Why is that not feasible? You save time, you save money, you don't create extra construction waste. Are you asking the deputy director? Well, SWD and HD. Well, if we were to do that, then at the very early stage, we need to identify the NGO. We have to shortlist the NGO. And we need to liaise with HD. Why can't you do that? As I mentioned, Area 9 in Taipo, you estimate how many youth centers, old age centers. Then you ask HD which block you can give me, how many units you can give me. Then you can do your planning. You can do the construction design. How you can plan for the washrooms and how big the units are. That will save time, save money. And you don't create construction waste. You have to, you know, the way you do it now, you have to build washrooms and it's demolished and redesigned. Why can't you do it planned ahead? We have the estate now, it's under planning, the whole construction site is there. Why can't you plan? HD, we've heard the views, and Housing Authority as developer for PRH, we will coordinate. Well, can you do the job rather than talk about coordination? We now have Area 9 in Taipo. What can you provide? We have SWD here. Which ground floor unit can be set aside? They can build the washrooms, plan the number of washrooms and everything.
Thank you, member. We will complement the work. That is, if the government's policy, under the current policy, relevant facilities are supposed to be very, you know, with premises with clean design. But if the policy changes, then we will have to change as a result. But as I said, we are very happy to provide support needed. Well, we're talking about an approach that costs less money and time. And why don't you do that? Why can't you do that? So, Mr. Yang, yeah, what's lacking there? Liang Youchong's proposal seems direct and simple. So what's wrong with that? You can go ahead with that. In Taipo area development, you can talk to SWD tomorrow and ask them what sort of facilities they want to see there. Yeah, Mr. Yang, why can't you make a promise here? Yeah, that is that if the required facilities are offered by Housing Authority, well, we have to look at the funding available as well. Under the current arrangement for residential units, they are to be funded by the Housing Authority. As for the other social welfare facilities, they are mainly funded by the government. As for whether we need to provide the facilities as well. Just then, the deputy director has commented on it. We have to wait till the organizations have been shortlisted and told us what sort of facilities they need. So the relevant vetting of the NGOs, where that can be done earlier, that's another issue. Okay, one request. Can the SWD and Housing Department give us a paper telling us whether the proposal is feasible or not, what we propose, that is? Well, HT says that they have to wait till the SWD find the SWD find the NGO first. But that can be done easily. Okay, Mr. Liang asked for a written reply from both departments. Maybe you can also move a motion. They need to tell us why the proposal is not feasible. Well, it will take long for them to come back with a paper. But I'd like to know what sort of difficulties they envisage. Okay, DD, is it clear to you? And HD? Well, we can provide you with information later on, but I think on this matter, we do need to study the matter a bit because it involves arrangements for open tenders for projects, so we need time to study the proposal. But we will discuss with the Housing Department and we'll try to provide paper to you together with the HD. Okay, I think we need to wrap up this item because of time. But we still have Roy Kwong, Leung Kok Hong, and Nathan Noh who haven't spoken yet. Should we draw a line then? We'll move into the next item after the trio have spoken. We also need to handle a motion. Okay, Roy Kwong. Thank you, Chairman. Having had all the views expressed, it seems like the government is just moving very slowly. SWD, HD, seems like you don't have good communication with each other. You seem to have followed the approach that has been around for a long time, but in untethered states, frontline social workers are operating on the streets. They just set up stores on the streets in the morning to provide services. And members are asking, that is for future estates, will we see the same scenario? That is, the SWD has to wait till they've identified the NGO first before asking the Housing Department to make arrangements for them. But we're saying that you could have got all this plan done before residents move into an estate. We now talk about an issue that affects a few months a year. T-shirt, why? We saw tragedies here there because of the lack of services and young people there grew up not even with any park or playground in the neighborhood. Social welfare services are very important, particularly for new housing estates. You can imagine if you're one of the new residents in the new estates. Okay, there were very few facilities there, little support for you. So social welfare facilities are intended to help them integrate into a new environment and support the need, what they need. So I don't see how HD and SBD have communicated with each other at all. So you're just actually being very, following the routine all along without any flexibility. DD, the SWD all along has had close contacts with the HD, particularly when a new housing estate is completed. So we do catch up with the housing department to find out what's the progress of building of housing estates, and we'll try to provide services there. So on the whole, we do have close liaisons with the housing department, and we are kept up to date on the progress of housing projects, and then we would in due course invite NGOs to provide service proposals. So why is it in non-tech state there are social workers setting up stores in the morning to provide services? Why? I think the main reason, as I said, is because after the occupation permit is approved or is given, there are still renovations or retrofittings needed at the premises. So I do hope that the NGOs, once they have moved into premises, they actually can operate smoothly there and provide services. In the estates, how long did it need for the premises to be fixed? For the youth sub-center in 2016, middle of July, occupation permit was issued, and in August, we all went together with the NGO to inspect the premises. Our colleagues from the buildings division went there, and we identified areas that need to be improved on, and that took 2 months to carry out the improvement works. Now it's April. That is from August 2016, after your inspection there, and it took you 2 months to make improvements and rectify the defects. What happened then? And after that, we applied for money to do the renovation, and then NGO had to submit a plan to the housing department for approval. I think Deputy Chairman was asking whether there's a chance for multitasking. Every time you're waiting for one task to be done before others can be done, can you do all those procedures and tasks at the same time? Hokaki was asking, how come there are so many defects that need to be rectified in your premises? Would the same thing happen to buildings, housing department offices? Next, before you enter the estate, if you go to the road leading to the estate, you can tell the contractors of the renovation workers saying were on the street, and they were also distributing leaflets. That's the case of Tek Long Estate and Kai Ching Estate. It's like in the exodus, you know, there's so many people there offering all sorts of interior decoration work. The decoration workers have got money already. They knew that the estates were there to actually canvas those. And also lots of money have been wasted in refurbishments of the estates. The Development Bureau, if it didn't give you the land, then you wouldn't be able to get the sites for building flats. And then the Housing and Transport Bureau could pose another obstacle. Then Labour Welfare Bureau, well, headed by Matthew Zhou, who's now the Chief Secretary, he's another barrier. His bureau could be another barrier. But now we're talking about an approach that should be people-centred. You've got the units built, whether people draw laws or wait on the official in the official queue for units. But you don't have any bargaining power. I think that's where the problem lies. Labour and Welfare Bureau, well, headed by Matthew Zhou, he's now the Chief Secretary. I don't have any expectations for him, but Paul Chen, who's now a financial secretary, well, and then head of the Labour and Transport Housing Bureau, Chen Pinglao, he's not going to serve another term. So what have we got? We need to see that it's wrong to say that we should be estate-focused, oriented, instead we should be supporting a people-oriented approach. In private housing estates, they always say that they have clubhouse. Have you seen any private housing estates that would not have their clubhouse open after all the residents have moved into their flats? After all the security guards have been hired? So please tell me. Housing department is not getting much done. Sometimes it really, you know, works for other departments, like highways department. It's really chaotic. So my question is, for the five major estates, the two Ontai estates, Kai Ching estate, Tek Long estate, plus Hong Shui Kiu, Hong Fuk estate, can you give us a workflow on how you're going to handle provision of social welfare facilities there? That is, how many procedures or steps would have to be followed before the services can be provided? Maybe the problem lies with the Development Bureau or with the Labor and Welfare Bureau. But can you give us a clear idea of the workflow, you know, for providing the facilities in those five major estates? Is that possible? Or would you approve people to set up tents outside the estates? I think your question is the same as what Fernando Jung asked, that is the mechanism and the workflow. The five estates, five major estates, the two on something estates, Hongfuk, and so forth, five major estates. Yeah, this is a pressing issue to us. Yeah, please show us the workflow, and then we'll see whether we can provide a solution. You know, there are two, you know, ministers who are having such a good time, so we could protest actually at the sites. Well, yeah, we can provide you with a paper on the workflow. Thank you. The last one is Nathan Law. Thank you. I've been sitting here the whole morning, and I found that communications and procedures were the problems here. Procedures should be intended to help people solve problems, but what we've seen is that procedures, on the contrary, failed. Not just fail to solve a problem, but also create more hardships, difficulties to the public. So we should indeed, you know, see officials and national members discussing how to perfect or enhance the procedures. We all understand that the purpose is not to follow the procedures, but rather our purpose is to improve people's livelihood and serve them. When you see that, you know, social welfare facilities at a housing estate are not ready till 1.5 years later, so that's an obvious problem. So why can't we think of solutions instead to overcome the problem? So I think we need to make reference to what members have said, for example, to streamline the procedures and also to enhance the tendering exercise. Why can't we actually act earlier so that the service providers can submit their plans earlier and the service facilities will be made available earlier as well? I really think that there is a communication gap between the two governments. So can you possibly overcome or plug that gap earlier? That is the housing department and the SWD should review their communication. I moved to Yatung Estate when I was in primary 3, and I found that there was no market there, so I could really feel. You know, I was very small in primary 3, but I didn't know what was happening. But my family members, looking back, I found that my family members did actually withstand a lot of pressure. So I truly, wholeheartedly feel that the government should resolve the problem. If the procedures could not provide a convenient solution, then we should change things.
There are a few points I'd like to raise. For example, we need to review the whole tender procedure. We need to speed it up. I think the NGOs are sincere. They are concerned about residents' issues. If you have to wait for a final building plan, they are aware if they follow the procedure, it will lead to delayed occupation. They want to coordinate with the government so that when people take occupancy, they can provide services. I'd like the government to have a clear requirement that before residents occupy the units, the services should be ready. In our planning guidelines, that is not included. We don't have a requirement that when the social services can be provided. Should be a very basic requirement. So I'd like the government to have a regulation. So within 3 months of occupation, or 3 months before occupation, these services should be ready. So whenever we build PRH, we won't repeat our old mistakes. And regarding Hong Kong planning standard guidelines, there is no clear requirement for nursery school or primary school. It just says depending on the circumstances. But we need at least one creche and one old age center. We now have an aging population. A lot of our young children don't have adequate care. We need to review the Hong Kong Planning Standard Guidelines. We need to have a minimum threshold, and on top of that, we have to consider whether we need extra services. Thank you. We don't require a response from the officials. We just need a written response. We now have two motions that we need to handle. While we read the motion, at the beginning, we had agreed to hold deputation meetings. So we'll invite SWD, HD, and Education Bureau. They also need to attend, because you are aware, for a lot of new residents, they have 10 days to enroll their children in the schools. It's now on a first-come, first-served basis. They cannot find schools in Kuntong, Zhangguanou. So that is not ideal. First-come, first-served, is that a good way approach? So we need to involve the Education Bureau, HD, SWD. So let's take a look at the two motions. Let's deal with Ms. Lau Siulai's motion. Well, it's very regrettable, this discussion we have today. Why can't we have early communication, have these facilities built? But another thing that we didn't have time to discuss was that these facilities are very insufficient. The whole on-dot estate has 20,000 people, but they only have one youth center and old age center. So for a population of 20,000, they have a lot of services. And we found that the services that they scheduled is insufficient. So can we conduct an 18 district consultation to provide the services? We need to review the Hong Kong Planning Standard Guideline. Your guideline has insufficient services. In the long run, we need it has to be social service oriented. We have people waiting in queues for 2-3 years. How can the old age handle that? So, members, those in favor, please raise your hand. I see it's unanimous, so we endorse that that motion. Second motion, Mr. Fernando Cheung. I'll just read it out. In light of all the PRH, residents have to they face inadequate shopping, education, facilities. So we need to establish a 5-year PRH service team, and the services such as nursery, elderly, family, youth services, this should be available before the PRH is occupied. And third, before the PRH is occupied, there should be planning to ensure that there is sufficient transport, education, medical facilities. Those who agree, please raise your hand. I see it's unanimous, so we'll endorse this motion. So that would conclude this agenda item. Thank you for government officials. The next agenda item. Progress of implementation of after-school care and support services. Let's welcome the government officials. this agenda item was raised by the SWD. We have Assistant Director of SWD and Google Light from SWD. So, Ms. Kwok, I'll report on our work. We'd like to talk about after-school care provided by SWD. We'd like to help low-income families so they can receive training or work. And there are two programs where we provide after-school care for children. We have an NGO providing after-school care program, and we also have a matching fund where they provide after-school care. So the after-school care program, essentially, we have a lot of NGOs. They target children between 6 and 12, and they provide homework assistance or parent assistance. And currently, we have 157 of these institutions providing this sort of assistance, and we can serve 5,800 clients. The usage rate is very high. It's 90%. The Social Welfare Department, in order to relieve parents' financial burden, starting from 2005, we had a fee reduction plan for after-school care. We will subsidize families who participate in the scheme, and we now have 1,800 recipients that receive full waivers. And to further assist families, some parents might have to work on weekends, and they work overtime during the week. So starting from 2014, we have a strengthened after-school care program. We'll extend the service till 9 o'clock, and the schools are also open on the weekends. We now have 35 of these centers providing we have a quota of 460 spaces, and the expenditure is $17 million. So after-school learning, starting from 2015, through a fund, we have $200 million funding, a matching fund. We invite NGOs and schools to cooperate. So through the four-party cooperation, we can provide this service. We are targeting the primary school, the middle school students, and the each service provider can receive funding of up to $3 million. And we now have granted funds for 149 projects, and involving so 170 million. So together with private sponsorship, the funding has reached 230 million. In the third round of application, we now have applications for 50 projects. So out of the 149 approved projects, 89 will be provided by 15 schools, and we also have 38 NGOs help us. The scheme itself is to help students' learning skills. We also have life planning. We also want to expand their experience and enhance their confidence. So the service content is very diverse. We have arts, sports, leadership training activities. this fund, we have after-school projects and also other projects. It provides very diverse services, and we feel that there is a need for these types of services. So for after-school program, we will keep a close eye on the district's needs, and we will have a flexible deployment, and we will also we can also adjust the number of service recipients flexibly. So the results are very encouraging, and that would conclude my report. Thank you, Ms. Kwok. You have a quota of 5,800. I heard that just now. Some 1,807. The fees are waived. It's about 30%. Only 30% received an exemption, a waiver, and so the other 70% they have to pay for it. But we see there's a big shortfall. You make it sound like you're very successful. Let me respond. The scheme is to help some low-income families. So we do have income assessment of the families. So if they are better off, we want them to pay for it. But for low-income families, we do have subsidies. So the assessment, if the family income, you have to compare it with the medium income. If they don't exceed 55% of the medium income, we have a 100% waiver. If their income is between 55% and 75% of the median income, we have a 50% reduction. So, I want to ask you, how many service users, how many of them are poor students? Do we have people who don't receive service for poor students? Theoretically speaking, for those who can enroll, they fulfill our criteria. Well, out of the 5,000 quota minus the 1,800, so the other children are not poor from poor families. The NGO, they will conduct the assessment. So if they discover that the family income is above the poverty line, they will be charged. So those children who are charged 100%, they are financially better off. I'd also like to mention that the 1,800 figure, the waiver, the exemption, they are not in the enhanced version. We have a quota of 420. So when you add the two, it's about 2,200 recipients. I see Gokake, Wang Bikwan, Pun Xiuping, and Lao Xiulai, and Kong Zhenyu, and also Liang Gohong. So let's make good use of our time. We also have another agenda item on the Integrated Family Service Center, Gokake. 3 minutes.
Chairman, across Hong Kong, there's so many children aged 6 and 12, and you only have 5,500 places. It's a shame. You know that our future CEO, Carrie Lam, kept saying that she would try all means to help release the labor force of women. But now we've only got a quota of 5,500, 800. And you're saying that you increased the quota, enhanced it by adding 400 more? We were talking about on-tech estates. In Diamond Hill alone, the need would exceed 5,500. So let me just ask you, can you tell me across Hong Kong, you know, children or families in such need, in need of the service. How many of them there are? Please tell me. How many would need the service? We will keep review. Well, this service is aimed at helping families. I was asking you the figure. Okay, you don't have to repeat that. Just give me the figure, the number of families in need of the service. I don't have the concrete figure, but we've always reviewed the usage of services in various districts. How did you come to this figure? It's based on the usage rate. But usage rate is now above 90%. Every half a year, we will carry out a review of the usage rate. So the quota will, on the basis of situation, be adjusted. People are drowning now, Chairman, and every month they're actually providing a prototype for a float. That's it. Why did I ask you this question? Because you are just coming up with a mere guess. You thought that there would be enough to provide 5,800 places. But for many grassroots families, they are in a dilemma because they couldn't take good care of their children. Assistant Director, maybe you have people who have money to hire foreign maids. But in these grassroots families, often they are stuck. The 90%, well, they're like, you know, claims made by hospitals. When they say 90% usage of the beds, indeed, and in reality, more than 100% or close to 100% of the beds are being used. So please don't just squeeze in resources. Please do a proper assessment first. Not just focus on a few districts alone. Do an overall assessment and then tell us how you can reach your target. When are you going to do the assessment? Let me supplement here. We have indeed, asked the organizations providing the after-school care service. And December last year, we found out that of the 5,800 places, they actually use up 90-odd%. There are still 400-plus places that were not used. So we'll keep reviewing the situation and see whether any change needs to be made. So we've not come to a stage where there are no surplus places. And also, through other service schemes like the support scheme that I just mentioned, which benefit more than 60,000 school children who are getting after school support. So we do not just rely on this particular after school care program alone. Next one, Fernando Jerome. Chairman, children benefiting from the ASCP, they do have special educational needs. Yet throughout the years, the number has been on the increase, and organizations have kept saying that they don't have enough staff, and neither do they have the adequate resources to hire experienced and trained young helpers. So they have to rely on university students to actually help the beneficiaries on a half voluntary basis. After school care, actually the demand for that is so big that I can be sure that actually we're not having or providing enough places, and the demand is a bit different now from before. SEN students have so much needs. I believe the SWD knows it very well. And the sector has also said that the amount of subsidy, that is $750 for each person, is too low to enable the hiring of proper staff. And also your subsidy ratio is very low. Most of the children getting the support are not given any subsidy. They have to pay, and the organizations have to run on a self-financing basis. So organizations losing money, but how much more can they lose? All along, we've asked you to raise your level of subsidy and also the number of beneficiaries. So SWD, as Guoka just asked, Has you clearly assessed the need there, if the need exists? So why haven't you responded? And many NGOs and social workers have also made complaints. Throughout the years, your amount of subsidy, when would you increase it? Okay. Ms. Kwok? Thank you, Mr. Jerome, for your views. We are aware of the issues you pointed out, including the amount of subsidy, whether it really can cover the cost. And also as for the number of beneficiaries, whether we do need to increase them. I think for both, we do have some plans in mind. As for the amount of subsidy, we do plan that within this year, we will increase the subsidy amount and we'll make reference to the market situation before making a decision. Internally, we have allocated resources for that. Can you tell us then here how much are you going to increase the subsidy by? Because the sector hopes to see it increase to $2,000. We have discussed with operating organizations and asked them about their fee level now. Our initial consideration is that it could go up to 900. How much? 900. That is up from 700 to 900. It will really depend on the situation in all the districts. The organizations charge differently. For some organizations, they're already charging 900. Some could charge even more than 1,000. But we'll look at the overall situation and also our resources and also the scope of services provided. Our thinking right now, for now, is to raise the amount to $900. How about the number of beneficiaries? Yeah, we are trying to increase the quota, but we're fighting for resources, hopefully. It can be increased too. We hope that within this year, the decision can be made. So we are still planning for the change, but we can't have definite answers until later on. So Fernando Jun was also talking about SEN students of your quota of 5,000 odd places. How many of them are SEN students? Many organizations are afraid of taking up SEN students for after school care because of the increase in resources needed. Okay, we've asked various organizations about their support for SEN students. Each center or all centers do have different numbers of SEN students. Their experience is that they often divide the students into groups. Even often in a group, there could be one or the most two SEN students. They feel that with their staff, establishment, if they can afford it, then they can support SEN students. But for after school care and support services, they are not so much focused on training or education, but to help provide care for the children, for parents who have to work. So for SEN students, we will not really need to help them or satisfy their learning needs through the after-school care. But organizations know that there are skills involved in interacting with SEN students or to help them concentrate better in the groups. So the organizations do provide training for their instructors. So of the quota of 5,800, how many of them are those using the support, how many of them are SEN students? And does SWD provide subsidy for SEN students? For the after-school care quota, we haven't kept any record of the number of SEN students getting the support. As for support for SEN students, because we don't have a particular breakdown for them, so the same fee waiving of 700 applies to them. Or is it that because you don't want to provide them with support at all? Next one is Pun Xiao Chun. for people who have to work, or parents have to work long, irregular hours, having the after-school care is something that we do support. But Chairman and other members have asked you, you know, about the demand for after-school care and support services, and you said that when situation arises, you would allocate or adjust the fee waiving quota. I don't know what you mean by, you know, a regular review. Is it half a year or what? Your enhanced arrangement or enhanced support, you said that 35 organizations can have more than 460 places using 70 million in total every year. But for the 35 centers, the distribution and the usage rate, are they, is the usage being even? Because each place costs about $36,000 and each center would incur an expense of $480,000. And you're talking about lengthening the support hours each day. It will be up to 9 p.m. But will it be the same for weekends? And secondly, members are asking about the 5,800 after-school care places. They are spread among more than 1,700 organizations. So the usage, would it vary from center to center? How would you, what yardstick would you use to evaluate the effectiveness of such support? If a center has more than the number of places or has a higher than average number of places being used, then would you increase the support or financial support? Yeah, we'll review the capacity regularly, and we do study with the regional office to see which centers provide more support and then allocate the resources accordingly to meet the needs of various districts. So we do a review every half a year. As for the enhanced service for after-school care, on the whole, we do encourage organizations, wherever district they are in, to provide the support. Situation has been fine so far, so there is after-school care almost in every district. Our latest statistics show that 76.6% of the services are being used. As for the time slots, on weekdays, it will be from 3 to 9 p.m. Weekends, it will be 8 hours a day at weekends. So organizations have flexibility in accordance with the needs of the children seeking support. As for school holidays, it's 10 hours a day. For some districts, if the demands are particularly great and if they need more places, then they can actually liaise with us. If possible, we can actually increase the places, not necessarily having to wait till our review is done on a half-year basis. Okay, next one is Selena Wong. As a chairman, we do support this after-school care support service because it's clearly a need for it.
The usage rate is some 90%, and even though you have a spare quota, but you will see some districts already at 100%. So do we have waiting times, and can we identify which districts need more resources and which need less, and you can adjust the quota? If we have districts that are already at full capacity, can you increase the quota? Because you're only spending $17 million a year, it's very minimal. But for the families in the districts, it's very important. Especially when you want to release labor, when you want to release more labor potential into the market. So if we can release mothers into work, you can allow the females in the family to go to work. It's good for society. So I suggest we increase the quota. This after-school care program is for 6 to 12-year-old students, primary school students. have you considered that for children 3 to 6 and under, the kindergarten, do they need after school care as well? Can you consider what is the need for a student under 6 years old? The kindergarten planning, we have out of 1,000 kindergartens, 250 are full day and 750 are half day. So I suggested the planning guidelines, it should be 50-50. That means that at least half the families after kindergarten, nobody can take care of their children. So if you can take the after school care program and extend it to kindergarten students, then those mothers or fathers can join the labor force. Will you consider that? Assistant Director, well, whether we can adjust the quota, there is room to do so. Especially we see for the enhanced after school care program, the quota is not used. It's only at 76.6%. So we can admit more students. And thank you for your review for increasing the quota. So this year we hope to increase that. Regarding care for young students, for younger students, there are some services available to them. We have the extended hours for the crush, and the quota is already increased. We also have a community caregivers, the community nannies. These are only used once in a while. But if you want to release mothers into the labor force, you cannot rely on the community nannies. The subsidized care facility, it's already full. It's 100%. Even the Labor Welfare Bureau, they are aware that it cannot provide services to the people that want it. Well, there are some plans in districts. We will have new independent care centers for young children. The crush, we also have extended hours to allow them to work longer at work. So we will keep a close eye on the development. We need more services for children between 3 to 6. Yes, I will reflect that to the Education Bureau. Lao Xiu Lai. These crush services after school are very important. The question is, as the other member said, the government provides very few services. So set aside the 5,800 quota in Hong Kong. Let's say in Kai Tak Estate, we have a population of 30,000 and there's only a quota for 50. And you said that you will review that every 6 months. We don't need to review, and you know that there's a significant shortfall of services. Second question, I know that the scheme, they require the parent to be working. If they're not, parent is not working, you will refuse their application. But when they're job seeking, they have to run around. They need a crush service. If you have that requirement, it's hard to release females into the labor force. So could you relax that requirement? They don't need to be at work. The third question is, when you respond that there's a shortfall for the after-school care program, you mentioned there's a fund, but this fund, we have always questioned its efficacy. For the paid services, the fees are very high. So how can you monitor the efficacy of this program? Regarding Kai Tak District, we are monitoring the situation through the district service center, and we will increase the quota if we see a demand. Well, there's only the whole estate, it's a grassroots residence. How can you just provide 50 seats? Well, regarding parents who are job seeking, well, it depends on the actual situation. In principle, we want to provide services for parents who are at work. So, when you're talking about job seekers, we don't know who is really looking for a job. So we have to consider each family case by case. There might be other social factors. We know some parents, they have difficulty. They might be have mental health problems. They might have a lot of children at home. They might have elderly parents at home. And it's not necessarily job seekers that have difficulties. We will consider each case individually. Well, I'm not satisfied with that answer. Are you the judge? How do you know if they are really job seeking? Well, they should make that request, and you should just relax that the people are at work. In principle, this is not a big problem. Parents who are job seeking, if they can tell the institute that they are job seeking, if we can confirm that it's a sincere application, so you're pledging that you can relax that for job seeking parents. The institution can consider that. The fund have high fees, and how do you monitor its efficacy? We don't charge the children fees. I'm not familiar with that. Regarding the commercial sector, we would like them to sponsor us. If they donate $1 million, we can match up by another $1 million, so the school will have $2 million to conduct the after-school care program. Could you explain? Well, according to media reports, the fund charges for its services. In 2012, they charged more than 1,000. And half of the parents feel that it's excessive. How come you're not aware of it? We don't have that information. So the schools, they receive our funding. They can conduct a lot of activities. So theoretically, they don't need to charge money for it. So for other schools and other activities, they charge, I'm not sure. So that's why I'm saying you're not monitoring the situation. Those institutes or schools, how much are they charging? What's the quality of the program? Do you have any statistics? Yes, I'd like to talk about monitoring. We don't want the fund to be abused, so when we receive an application, we will examine, we will scrutinize their application and how they will use the money. And the institute needs to implement a program. They will, after they receive sponsorship, then we will release our funds. For plans, for schemes that run longer than a year, we will fund them in phases. We won't give them the money in one go. If they cannot provide sufficient information, we can suspend the issuing of funds. The institutes also need to prove that they used the commercial sponsorship, and if there is a minimal revenue, they have to spend that first. So we will require them to fulfill that step before we fund them. If they cannot use the funds completely, they have to return it to the government. They have to provide progress report, review report, and an audited financial report to prove how the money was used. the fund members and secretary will visit the programs, will monitor the progress and see whether it is satisfactory. We have to end here. Ms. Kong Jun Yu and Kok Hong. Well, after school care crush, my first job was within a youth center, and well, we provided after school care crush, and there is a story behind each crush case. The father and mother want to work. This is something that needs to be promoted. If you imagine if we can release parents, especially if the children need crèche services, we need, the government needs to provide this assistance. So Ms. Lau Xilai raised a similar question. Do they have to have a job first, or does the child care come first? For frontline services, they require parents to have a job first. So this is a chicken and egg problem. If you want to be employed, you need time to find a job, and having a child would make it difficult for job interviews and so on. I have a question about timing. A person, when they apply for crèche service, how long do they have to wait? Well, I've heard that some people have waited for 2 years. So I want to verify, is that true? Regarding job seeking, we allow even parents who wish to take training. That is a suitable reason for after school crèche services. So that will not the child will not be denied service because of that. Well, how long do they need to wait? It depends on the individual centers. Some centers, they are in demand, and some centers have a leftover quota, they don't need to wait. So those in demand, they might have to wait longer, but we don't have statistics. Well, I can tell you, even for a short wait, it's quite substantial. I worked in a youth center 10 years ago, and we had a table where people could apply, and I recall 10 years ago, some cases they had to wait for years. They would come and visit every week or so and ask, do we have a vacancy? So if we can release more mothers into the job market, and children can get a crèche service, mothers and fathers, they need to work, and the children are left at the park. Some kids have to go home by themselves, so there are safety concerns. So I hope you can provide more services. We need, overall speaking, the 5,800 quota is not fully utilized. Some districts are at saturation. So we will liaise with our institutes, and we need to provide more quotas and services. The social workers are also very good. They identify the needs, and even with 100% saturation, they can provide short-term services. To hope we can come up with a short-term arrangement.
Next one, Lan Kong Hong, 90% usage rate. Well, we heard that as the Hokaki said, well, there are some time frames when people wouldn't use the service, so actually it could be 100% usage rate. So let me play a game with you. From now on, you can say that people register online for service will be guaranteed a place. Do you dare to play that game? If you dare to, then I will call a press conference telling people that the after-school care service will be available should they click online and put down their contact number. Well, definitely can tell you that You were not there to play that game. Would you dare to? If not, that means you are just fooling us around. In the 18th century, before the French Revolution, the word kindergarten came about because both parents were from 10 to 14 hours. So they had to let some other people look after the children. So the kindergarten were run either as a charity or because the employers would just let them put their children aside at the workplace while they're working. By 1815, someone called Owen, well, a socialist, who actually ran mines and farmlands, and also opened kindergartens. And the idea was brought to England. It's not something new. When we talk about kindergarten now, and you're saying that we don't have enough staff, and people are paid a low wage, and the transportation costs are so high, people work so hard, and the children of these, you know, hardworking laborers just need to be well taken care of. You are getting money, you should get money to help these children. We're talking about an old concept that dates back to the 18th century, before the French Revolution in 1789. So let me tell you, people register online. Should they want the service? And if they can't get it after registering online, what would be the penalty? You said there are enough places. You said that of the 18 districts, you said that if there are not enough places, would you bear the consequence? You said that you want to mend divisions in society, or to give Hong Kong harmony. Well, would you dare to accept the challenge? I never said that we had enough places already. We don't need to get more support. All along, we have been liaising, actually have had close contacts with the operating organizations. I actually put my hat on the line. If I lose, I wouldn't be DQ'd. If I lose this game, I would quit as a legislator. Well, in fact, we do know which families have registered for help. The reality is, not many of them may need the service on Monday to Friday. They just need the service maybe on some days, some hours. So we need to keep track of the actual needs. For online registering, I wouldn't comment. And
其實現在個情況,
well, the welfare card in the US is more important than ID card. And if you actually want to know what the demand for welfare services is, you can just check up the data of people with a welfare card. It's like giving out $6,000. If you give out this benefit, people living overseas, the Hong Kong people living abroad will come back to get it. Okay, let me ask this question. For the study on aftercare support service, after school care service for children aged 0 to 9, what are the results of the study? As far as we know, I think a research team has been set up, but for details of the study, I'm not well aware yet, because it's done by another team. If needed, I can ask them for information. Yeah, because the childcare policy would include after school care, right? Yes, I think we need to wrap up this item. Thank you. Deputations from the administration. So now we will talk about the last item. Using my power as the chairman, I will extend the meeting by 15 minutes, that is to 1 p.m. See, or we could extend it to 1:10 further, because this is depends. Well, this is a big issue anyway. Let's welcome the deputations from the Social Welfare Department. The item is review of the role and staff establishment of integrated family service centers of the SWD. We have with us Assistant Director of SWD, Mr. Fong, and Chief Social Worker Officer, Ms. Loi. Because of time, so maybe the administration, could you take us through the paper in 4 minutes, not more than 4 minutes? Okay. Thank you, Chairman. I think you've read our paper. I'll just be very brief. In the 1990s, with rapid social changes and economic changes, in 2000, August, the SWD, through open tender, commissioned Hong Kong U to conduct a review on the implementation of IFSC service mode so as to make the service more effective and comprehensive in response to family needs. In 2001 June, the report was issued recommending the government to adopt the IFSC mode so as to provide remedial and also support to help families with urgent needs. And after reallocation of resources in 2004 and 2005, the SWD by phases set up 61 IFSCs across the territory. Since then, in 2008 October, through open tenders, we've commissioned the Hong Kong U to carry out the review of the implementation of the IFSC operation mode and also to assess the effectiveness of the services. And in 2015, a review report was released confirming the support mode or service mode, and also recommendation was made that publicly funded NGOs should continue to provide IFSC, which is community-based, family-focused, and child-centered. And the guiding principles are accessibility, early identification, integration, and partnership. Each IFSC consists of three major components, including the family resource unit, family support unit, and family counseling unit. Provides a range of preventive, supportive, and remedial services to individuals and families in need. The units have clear areas of service, that is, they serve up to 10,000, a population of 10,000 people, depending on the types of complexity of the problems. Each center has 1 to 13 social workers. Each SWD operator IFSC is in the range of from 21 to 36 in terms of staff establishment. And the centers would actually handle a number of cases. In 2004 to 15, in that decade, our department has been reviewing staff establishment in the centers, looking at the demand of frontline help. We have increased frontline services by 25% from 896 to more than 1,000. And also, we've increased, actually, in 2013 to 14, increased such centers from 61 to 65, that is the IFSCs. 41 of them are run by SWD, and 24 others are run by NGOs. Thank you. That's my brief introduction to the paper. Thank you, Assistant Director. Members, if you have questions, please indicate to us. Fernando Chun, Chen Chi Chun have asked to speak. Okay, Chen Chi Chun first. Thank you, Chairman. My question is on the services provided for sexual minorities. We had a debate with the government a long time ago on whether we should have dedicated services for sexual minorities. The government stance is that, okay, you can just look for IFSC to see what sort of dedicated services they can provide, because they can provide all sorts of services. But you know that IFSCs cannot do everything. If they don't have specialized training or special staff, they would not be able to provide useful service. In the worst scenario, they could even harm the potential clients. I heard cases where sexual minorities sought help at a center. The social worker told them, well, strict that they should evaluate their sexual orientation. And for some sexual minorities who left home because of conflicts with the families, the social worker told them that, well, this is the trouble that you brought to yourself because you had not sought changes to your sexual orientation. So maybe it's a matter of values or lack of experience. You know, many NGOs have religious backgrounds. So the staff there have their own values, and that could affect the service they provide. Early last year, there was a report submitted by a special task force that found out that frontline social workers should be given training, and also resources should be allocated for training on sensitivity for social workers, because we need to avoid social workers hurting their potential clients. So we should review the resources for IFSC so they can better cope with the needs of sexual minorities. So has the SWD really looked at the possibilities of providing more training, better training, or would you insist on getting IFSCs to handle problems faced by sexual minorities? Mr. Fung? Thank you, Chairman. I think Mr. Chen actually used to sit on a case conference involving domestic violence handled by SWD. Our stance is that for of the 65 IFSCs and the two other integrated centers, they are for everyone in Hong Kong. We don't label anyone coming to the centers for services. And I've taken on board members' views and reviewed the training aspect. Therefore, in the past 2 years, we have enhanced our training of workers, you know, who have to serve or who come into contact with sexual minorities. I think Mr. Chen may recall a case that even though many of our NGOs have religious backgrounds, but as a social worker, they're not supposed to discriminate, you know, against anyone. So it wouldn't be, you know, differences in religious background that the social worker denying them services. I told you a case in the past, right? Some organizations gave me a letter thanking me for, you know, through the IFSC operated by a Christian organization, that we provided help to a person of, you know, who are members of sexual minorities. So we do meet with the welfare organizations, or even police, to sit down, to have more communications. So we'll continue with this kind of work. Hopefully, we can beef up our training for frontline workers so the social workers can better understand the needs of their target clients. Thank you.
I'm aware that there are very open social workers from church-affiliated NGOs. So under the IFSC, can we have specialized services where these service providers are experienced, they can serve these sexual minorities, and they can have specialized services? Well, you are asking for single parents and LGBT service centers, well, can these be established? Well, in the 2010 Hong Kong U report, we found that groups with special needs, if they could receive service in the same environment, psychologically and other areas, it's better, it's easier for them to receive service. we're not asking for a specialized center in IFSC. Could you have a specialized team? So in case deployment, the case manager will deploy cases according to frontline staff training and experience. But we won't say that the government will have a deployment every 3 or 4 years. If there's only one person that can do it, then when that person is deployed then to another posting, then does that mean the services cannot be provided? So we will adjust training according to the service demand. We need to focus on training and actual work experience. So Mr. Chan is not saying that the training is not necessary, but some people might have a calling in certain areas. Mr. Fernando Chung, I agree with Mr. Chan Jishun. The groups of special needs, the IFSC, their role cannot provide that service. We have the single parent center or new immigrant centers. These services have been absorbed into the IFSC. That is not appropriate. Individual social workers can lead a team, but that cannot be generalized. You have a 60-plus person in each IFC. Is that the case for all IFCs? So single parents or other special groups, do they like to join these teams? No. Each district has different needs, and they don't have an identity. If the center serves a particular community, they can identify with it. Single parents, they might feel they are discriminated. They cannot integrate into a regular IFSC. So this has been argued for many years. Ethnic minorities, there are a few ethnic minority centers, but single parent centers are not on the agenda. So the service provision from the social welfare perspective, we are aware that it's not feasible. You have 40 teams of SWD social workers and 20 NGOs. So, forget about the statutory cases. Just talk about housing department, compassionate housing deployment. All PRH arrangements, the NGOs can't handle that. It has to be dealt with by the IFSC under the SWD. So why can't you delegate the housing deployment and allow NGOs to do it? You don't need to have so many layers of bureaucracy. We ought to have a community-based, we need to have a service based on the community. Even if you have outreach facilities in the IFC, it's just empty talk. This is just a remedial solution. You are not building a community. We don't have that important social work function. We cannot build the community. So everybody is just revolving around problems. So we need to review the IFSC. We shouldn't just look at the IFSC. We need to look at each community, and it should be examined from a community development perspective. we need to see how families can be supported from a community perspective. Well, first of all, I have to thank Mr. Fernando Chung for his comments. After establishment of the IFSC, we had scattered work. We were able to coordinate it under one roof, and some work can be handled by IFSC, as you and you had given us some examples. So the compassionate housing is now under review. In November last year, we had established a task force, and in March, they had five focus groups, including frontline workers, interested parties, and other services, because we have child protection services and also mental health services being handled by IFSC. Now, regarding the authority of the NGOs, well, this is a social resource, and we agree with the HD that the government should play a role in the process. So, after all the information is considered, if they feel if there's no need for remedial housing, the NGOs, they can also make a similar decision at the middle level. So in this review, we will examine the whole procedure. That is the division of labor, the delegation of authority, and so on. Mr. Chung talked about building a community. That would cross, that would involve more than one government department and bureau. We have a family support unit that relies on outreach, a volunteer, sharing of experience, and so on. So we can build a more caring society through these efforts. So you said that there were five focus groups in March. When will we get the results? Well, the next step is to collate the views, and we expect that after summer holidays, we can convene the second round of focus groups. We want to highlight, some salient points and focus on that in September. So September, you'll have a second round of focus group. So if things run smooth, then in March 2018, we should have a conclusion. That is how CRs and NGOs, they delegate authority. So before the conclusion, I hope that by September or after the second round, you should submit your findings to the Welfare Services panel so that LegCo can participate. Because if you wait till the conclusion, and if we object, then it's pointless. Mr. Fung agreed that we could discuss that in September. Well, you don't have to worry. This is an open discussion. We already have a roadmap, a timetable, and agenda items, all this is on the internet. The whole review is visible on our website. Mr. Gerald had asked for transparency in our work before. So regarding the role of the IFSC, you have been referring to the Family Resource Unit, the Family Support Unit, and Family Counseling Unit. So it should be resource, support, and then counseling, a triangle. But now a lot of institutes tell me that the situation is actually upside down. The most of the time is spent on counseling, and then support, and only finally on resource. So they cannot put out the fires. So the IFSC the whole niche is misplaced. Is that the case? Well, the whole IFSC operation, we have an IFSC committee, and they convene every 3 months. We have NGOs and frontline workers in this meeting, and they keep a close eye on the work. We have not heard strong views that, well, you have met a lot of concern groups and unions, that your original pyramid has been turned upside down. The resources is now focused on counseling, so you cannot provide adequate support. Well, I mentioned that in the last few years, we have been adding human resources. So given these conditions, we mentioned that every 3 months in our IFSC committee, we can follow up further. Do you have frontline workers in your committee? Yes, from social welfare department, NGOs. We like to, and on the last occasion, we met with frontline NGO staff. We also have union concern groups that want to participate. Can you consider that? Well, the CR, we have included frontline workers. We have focus groups that invited all the unions. Next, Mr. Leung Kong Hong. Well, you have not answered Mr. Chan's questions. The IFSC, since its inception in 2001 to 2010, you are not addressing those questions. So the IFSC should be helping to build families. Well, if we have other sexual inclinations, of course they are not supporting those. We're supporting one husband, one wife families. So service provision under the IFSC, being a community-based development, and then you have a Family Resource Unit, Family Support Unit, and Family Counseling Unit. It's all family-based. So I want to ask.
You said that you have tens of centers serving 10,000 to 150,000 people each. But I can see problems there. As Chairman Xie said, you know, it's like family counseling comes first of your three areas of work. But you don't have adequate resources, so you have to find a way, as Venerable Jern mentioned, to accumulate social district capital, because you are serving 10,000 to 150,000 per district. So why can't you, if you want to provide self-help, you need to delegate powers, that is NGOs, you know, should be given the role to play. With limited resources, you say that you would actually get the government to control resources, but I think it's self-contradictory. Human rights are human rights. If NGOs see something that needs to be addressed, then you can't say that, well, you change the nature of a problem because of limited resources. If you are short-sighted, you are short-sighted. If an optometrist says that you are short-sighted and you say, no, he can see things and we don't have enough glasses, so we can't treat it as a problem of short-sightedness. But the problem is there, after all. So you can't just go for a shortcut alone. So we are dealing with a serious problem now. If you use IFSC as the basis for district-based service, serving different goals, then, well, NGOs, if they don't have resources, well, if you ask NGOs to provide services on your behalf, and yet you curtail their powers because of limited resources. That is when the NGOs go out to provide family support and family counseling, their services will be hindered. You heard cases, right? Examples of various cases. So since resources are so precious, and if you think that the government place is the best party to offer the help, then if NGO thinks that help should be given in a case, then what would you do? Would you really offer the help or not, given the limited resources? Are you really there empowering the cases in need of help? I think we totally respect staff at NGOs because they have undergone professional social work training. So NGOs can deal with compassionate or issues related to compassionate housing. If they see a need or adequate grounds for compassionate housing, then they can refer the case to SWD for approval. Then the case could be submitted to housing department. It's not that because it's an NGO, we will not let them handle the case. It's just that we hope we can actually apply a consistent approach. That is, that there'll be 11 officers making the decision. Well, you've outsourced your work, you know, the work to vetting applications. And when I challenged the decisions, when I threatened to launch JR, I found out that, you know, ultimately the gatekeeper is the government. So what can we do? We are not helping with the international service, social service. No, we work with international social service before, and we knew about cases. Well, for other services, if anyone is dissatisfied with the services provided, they can make a case or raise a case to the management of the NGO or complain to the district or make an appeal to the district welfare officer under SWD as well. I remember you handled, Mr. Lau, you handled a case that came to the attention of our district welfare officer. And the officer would help the aggrieved person. So the mechanism is there. So anyone who is dissatisfied with the service can refer the case or make a complaint to the district welfare officer. Even though there are 11 welfare officers coordinating or responsible for vetting of applications for compassionate housing, but we are saying that sometimes the criteria for giving compassionate housing are not consistent. It seems like it's better, as some social workers propose, to set up a dedicated team on compassionate housing. I know that's an important focus of consultation. I hope that you can consider. Besides hearing from the listening to the views of the steering committee, social workers concern group have said that setting up dedicated teams can be really useful. And secondly, on the issue of inadequate manpower up to now, well, I haven't asked this, but I'd like to know how many of the IFSCs have staff establishments that exceed the requirement or the criteria for serving 100,000 to 150,000 people? For centers that are serving in a district or serving a target population of more than 150,000, what can you do? Because some of the staff in those centers are really overworked. Integrated means that the centers will be overloaded with all kinds of work. Please respond. I think setting up dedicated teams to deal with compassionate housing cases, we've heard that. So in our first round of a focus group meetings, we discussed that. We will continue to get more information and see what we can do. As I said, we'll also look at the overall division of work as well, considering work being done by other centers other than IFSC. As for centers serving more than 150,000 people, there's only one center that is serving more than 150,000 people, just barely above 150,000. But there are also centers serving less than 100,000 people. So we'll ask the welfare officer to see whether they need to redraw the lines, boundaries of service areas. Population fluctuates from district to district. And we also need to, besides population, the actual needs in the district or in service area. The complexity of cases there as well. So it's not just based on population alone. So in some centers, or for some centers, like in Shem Shui Po, they are serving less than 100,000 people, but we won't withdraw resources because of their limited or lesser population or number of people being served. As for resources, for the FSA, even though I think we would expect centers to report to us cases carry forward from one period to a new period. So we will look at the overall picture. As for the service agreement, they are actually documents that need to be reviewed over time. And so we'll see what the review committee thinks. And actually, it's among the 26 recommendations for us to review the SFA. In our committee, there is a special task force doing the follow-up work needed. And in 2011-2012, they've just updated the subsidized service agreement. We don't want to make things complicated. We don't want to make our colleagues or organizations keep reporting a large number of data to us. So we need to avoid that. You're making things too complicated. So we will only collect, for us and for frontline organizations and Council of Social Service, we only ask for data that are really important. For the data on the SIS forms, we are already aware of them. Okay, thank you. I think that's it for our meeting. We need to adjourn the meeting. But please note that, if a social worker at the IFSC has to deal with 80 cases, that's impossible. Don't tell me. I think the average is 36 point something cases. Yeah, 36.8 per social worker. That is number of cases. Well, let me give you some fresh figures. Thank you. Meeting adjourned.